change as we live. When we look back to our past, we might to start to appreciate those things that we have never cared about before. Recalling my middle school years in China, I realized now that I was driven by an itching desire, or maybe I should say, a juvenile urge to do something different. My middle school is located in the former French concession of Shanghai, the territory that the Chinese government once conceded to France for peace settlement. Every morning, bus number 43 took me across the narrow streets of the French concession, while watching those familiar tree-lined avenues and old buildings with faded colors passing by. I knew another day of insipid routine had begun. As a teenager who was rather nonchalant, I spent most of my time without a clear goal. However, it did not take me too long to realize that it was not the life I wanted. Although teachers had regarded me as an obedient child, I was in fact a rebel inside. The desire for change gnawed at my mind every day and soon became intolerable. At that time, my seat was right beside the window in the front row, and I could see the Oriental Pearl TV Tower located by the side of Huangpu River, which is one of the most famous landmarks in Shanghai. It always quietly stood there, symbolizing the magnificence of the city. Although born and raised in Shanghai, I had never had a chance to visit the tower. I was so fascinated by the tower that I could not shift my attention from it. During class time, I spent much time staring at the TV tower, calculating the number of buildings lying between the tower and me, watching the dramas happening on the streets and allowing my brain to space out rather than listening to my teachers. I constantly imagined myself sneaking out of the window, leaving behind the old life that had been restricting me for so long. Much to my dismay, I realized that my wish to change could never be achieved unless I found what was important to me. In my middle school, students were encouraged to attend weekend tutoring classes to improve the grades, and I was among one of them. As rebellious as I was, I chose to skip the classes most of the time and took bus to People Square in the city center, the most crowded place in Shanghai. I wandered aimlessly on the streets, watching those passengers who I might never meet again in life, and sometimes going to a random shopping mall for air conditioning and bubble tea. I never stopped observing while I was walking, and I was always enchanted by the increasing grandeur of my city, which had been ignored by me for a long time. It was such a pleasure to see the harmony created by the city of Shanghai and its people. Its inclusiveness as a city has tightened us together as one. Despite the guiltiness of skipping classes, I did feel satisfied and happy. The experience of walking on the streets had deepened my awareness of Shanghai. My own existence was minimized in the huge city crowd. However, I could feel a subtle emotion burgeoning inside my heart. Then I realized what was important to me and what should I cherish. In 2009, I decided to study photography in order to record the beauty of my city and people around me. I could still remember the pure excitement of getting my first digital camera. After becoming a photographer, I changed my previous hermit lifestyle and went out to experience the outdoors. I always chose to walk instead of taking public transportation, because in the process of walking, I could always find unexpected beauty. Photography gave me the ability to be myself without confining rules. No one could ever dictate how I should perceive the world. And the act of photography helps me search for identification with a vast world of wonder. The French concession, the place I once considered to be a jail, after my graduation from middle school, had become my fondest place in Shanghai. I started to take pictures of old buildings scattered around the French concession, including those that were going to be demolished. I spent two summers visiting every remaining old building and took pictures of people who lived in them. Those people seemed to be excluded from the clamor of this metropolitan city and lived old lifestyles that had been abandoned by most people. I became more aware of my own existence as I took more pictures. For me, photography serves as the best medium to preserve memories and heritage, and it became one of the few things I was emotionally attached to. Those antique buildings in Shanghai represent a vital bond that unites us together in our common heritage, while those new ones indicate the possibilities of the future. As long as the photographs remain, the joys and sorrows we shared within those buildings shall stand inscribed within the colors of the images. They shall not fall to become a mere speck of sand in the quiet flow of all-obscuring time. This summer, I brought one of my best friends from another province to see my middle school at night. As we walked across the narrow streets in the darkness without talking to each other, a familiar feeling rushed back to me, almost created an illusion that the time has never left. We stopped by the front gate of my middle school and both of us remained silent. My school stood still among the old buildings, surrounded by dim street lights with nobody in there. I put my hand on the dusty wall, feeling the roughness of the stones. I also searched for that window that I once looked through and finally found it. After so many years, my urge for change had gone, and I started to wish time remained unchanged. I also knew that there would no longer be a teenage girl who always looks through the window to see the TV tower, because I have already left. There wasn't such concept as hometown in my mind until I left Shanghai, and the memories have transfigured themselves into something significant as time went by. Although my middle school is merely an old building, it has witnessed a lapsing of time and thus became an inseparable part of my memory. Inside that building, I have read so much ancient Chinese poetry about people's nostalgia for their hometowns, which sometimes reduced them to tears. I finally realized it was not literary exaggeration. It was true. Shanghai is certainly not a city with the cleanest air or the nicest people. However, this city was my first impression of this world. Its familiar smell and its significance to me can never be captured in photographs. In the quotation Dr. Hill read earlier, the protagonist Holden Caulfield in the book attempted to distance himself from the inevitable process of change rather than accepting the reality and move on. His fantasy eventually came to an end because life never compromises to people. Only people compromise to life. Time never waits for people. The subjects that are being photographed will stand still forever in the frame. We are the ones who have to move on and continue exploring the infinite possibilities of life. I have always thanked photography for allowing me to experience the world and preserve all the precious memories. But I have also realized that the photographs are merely photographs. They can neither stand for the present nor replace those things I have missed in my life. The photographs should never impose limits on me, and nothing could hinder me from embracing the future. Not a window, not my middle school, not photography, and not the city of Shanghai that I love so deeply with all my passions. Although I have left so many things behind, the photographs I took will always serve to remind me of who I am and give me faith in life during the hardest days. There might be one day I will never pick up my camera again, but keep in mind that we all have something that is more powerful than the photographs to remember those great moments in life. After all, life still goes on.